A Niece of Snapshot Harry's. By Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 2. 2. The robbery furnished the usual amount of copy for the local press. There was the inevitable compliment to Yuba Bill for his well-known coolness, the conduct of the young expressman, who, though new to the service, displayed an intrepidity that only succumbed to numbers, was highly commended, and even the passengers received their meed of praise, not forgetting the lady, who accepted the incident with the light-hearted pleasantry characteristic of the Californian woman. There was the usual allusion to the necessity of a vigilance committee to cope with this organized lawlessness, but it is to be feared that the readers of the Red Dog Clarion, however ready to lynch a horse thief, were of the opinion that rich stage express companies were quite able to take care of their own property. It was with full cognizance of these facts and their uselessness to him that the next morning Mr. Ned Bryce turned from the road where the coach had just halted on the previous night and approached the settler's cabin. If a little less sanguine than he was in Yuba Bill's presence, he was still doggedly inflexible in his design, whatever it might have been, for he had not revealed it even to Yuba Bill. It was his own. It was probably crude and youthful in its directness, but for that reason it was probably more convincing than the vacillations of older counsel. He paused a moment at the closed door, conscious, however, of some hurried movement within which signified that his approach had been observed. The door was opened, and disclosed only the old woman. The same dogged expression was on her face as when he had last seen it, with the addition of querulous expectancy. In reply to his polite good morning, she abruptly faced him with her hands still on the door. "Ye kin stop right there. Ef yer want ter make any talk about this yar robbery, ye might easy well skedaddle to once it, for we ain't talking any today." "I have no wish to talk about the robbery," said Bryce quietly, "and as far as I can prevent it, you will not be troubled by any questions. If you doubt my word or the intentions of the company, perhaps you will kindly read that." He drew from his pocket a still damp copy of the Red Dog Clarion and pointed to a paragraph. "What's that?" she said querulously, feeling for her spectacles. "Shall I read it?" "Go on." He read it slowly aloud. "I grieve to say it had been jointly concocted the night before at the office of the Clarion by himself and the young journalist, the latter's assistance being his own personal tribute to the graces of Miss Flo." It read as follows. "The greatest assistance was rendered by Hiram Tarbox, Esq., a resident of the vicinity, in removing the obstruction, which was, no doubt, the preliminary work of some of the robber gang, and in providing hospitality for the delayed passengers. In fact, but for the timely warning of Yuba Bill by Mr. Tarbox, the coach might have crashed into the tree at that dangerous point, and an accident ensued more disastrous to life and limb than the robbery itself." The sudden and unmistakable delight that expanded the old woman's mouth was so convincing that it might have given Bryce a tinge of remorse over the success of his stratagem, had he not been utterly absorbed in his purpose. "Hiram," she shouted suddenly. The old man appeared from some back door with a promptness that proved his near proximity, and glanced angrily at Bryce until he caught sight of his wife's face. Then his anger changed to wonder. "Read that again, young feller," she said exultingly. Bryce reread the paragraph aloud for Mr. Tarbox's benefit. "That A.R. Hiram Tarbox, Esquire, means you, Hiram," she gasped, in delighted explanation. Hiram seized the paper, read the paragraph himself, spread out the whole page, examined it carefully, and then a fatuous grin began slowly to extend itself over his whole face, invading his eyes and ears, until the heavy, harsh, dogged lines of his nostrils and jaws had utterly disappeared. "Be gosh," he said, "that's square. Kin I keep it?" "Certainly," said Bryce. "I brought it for you." "Is that all ye came for?" said Hiram, with sudden suspicion. "No," said the young man frankly. Yet he hesitated a moment as he added, "I would like to see Miss Flora." His hesitation and heightened color were more disarming to suspicion than the most elaborate and carefully prepared indifference. With their knowledge and pride in their relatives' fascinations, they felt it could have but one meaning. Hiram wiped his mouth with his hand, assumed a demure expression, glanced at his wife, and answered. She ain't here now. Mr. Bryce's face displayed his disappointment. But the true lover holds a talisman potent with old and young. Mrs. Tarbox felt a sneaking maternal pity for this suddenly stricken Strephon. She's gone home, she added more gently, went at sunup this morning. Home, repeated Bryce. Where's that? Mrs. Tarbox looked at her husband and hesitated. Then she said a little in her old manner, her uncle's. Can you direct me the way there? Asked Bryce simply. The astonishment in their faces presently darkened into suspicion again. If that's your little game, began Hiram, with a lowering brow. I have no little game but to see her and speak with her, said Bryce boldly. I am alone and unarmed, as you see, he continued, pointing to his empty belt and small dispatch bag slung on his shoulder, and certainly unable to do anyone any harm. I am willing to take what risks there are. And as no one knows of my intention, nor of my coming here, whatever might happen to me, no one need know it. You would be safe from questioning. There was that hopeful determination in his manner that overrode their resigned doggedness. If we knew how to direct you there, said the old woman cautiously, ye'd be killed outer hand afore ye even set eyes on the girl. The house is in a holler with hills kept by spies, ye'd be a dead man as soon as ye crossed its boundary. What do you know about it? Interrupted her husband quickly, in querulous warning. What are ye talking about? You leave me alone, Hiram. I ain't going to let that young feller get popped off without a show, or without knowing just what he's got to tackle, know how ye can fix it? And can't ye see he's bound to go, whatever ye says? Mr. Tarbox saw this fact plainly in Bryce's eyes, and hesitated. The most that I can tell ye, he said gloomily, is the way the gal takes when she goes from here, but how far it is, or if it ain't a blind, I can't swore, for I haven't been there myself, and Harry never comes here but on an off night, when the coach ain't running and there's no travel. He stopped suddenly and uneasily, as if he had said too much. There ye go, Hiram, and ye talk of others gabbling. So ye might as well tell the young feller how that there ain't but one way, and that's the way Harry takes, too, when he comes here once it in an age to talk to his own flesh and blood, and see a Christian face that ain't aging him. Mr. Tarbox was silent. Ye know where the tree was thrown down on the road, he said at last. Yes. The mountain rises straight up on the right side of the road, all hazel brush and thorn where a goat couldn't climb. Yes. But that's a lie, for there's a little trail, not a foot wide, runs up from the road for a mile, keeping it in view all the while, but bane hidden by the brush. Ye can see everything from there, and hear a teamster spit on the road. Go on, said Bryce impatiently. Then it goes up and over the ridge, and down the other side into a little gulch until it comes to the canyon of the North Fork, where the stage road crosses over the bridge high up. The trail winds round the bank of the fork and comes out on the left side of the stage road about 1,000 feet below it. That's the valley and hollow where Harry lives, and that's the only way it can be found. For all along the left of the stage road is a sheer pitch down that 1,000 feet, where no one can get up or down. I understand, said Bryce, with sparkling eyes. I'll find my way all right. And when ye get there, look out for yourself, put in the woman earnestly. Ye may have regular greenhorn's luck and pick up Flo afore ye cross the boundary, for she's that bold that when she gets lonesome o' stayin' there she goes wanderin' out o' bounds. Hev ye any weapon any shootin' iron about ye? Asked Tarbox, with a latent suspicion. The young man smiled, and again showed his empty belt. None, he said truthfully. I ain't sure if that ain't the safest thing arter all with a shot like Harry, remarked the old man grimly. Well, so long, he added, and turned away. It was clearly a leave-taking, and Bryce, warmly thanking them both, returned to the road. It was not far to the scene of the obstruction, yet but for Tarbox's timely hint, the little trail up the mountainside would have escaped his observation. Ascending, he soon found himself creeping along a narrow ledge of rock, hidden from the road that ran 50 yards below by a thick network growth of thorn and bramble, which still enabled him to see its whole parallel length. Perilous in the extreme to any hesitating foot, at one point, directly above the obstruction, the ledge itself was missing, broken away by the fall of the tree from the forest crest higher up. For an instant Bryce stood dizzy and irresolute before the gap. Looking down for a foothold, his eye caught the faint imprint of a woman's shoe on a clay rock projecting midway of the chasm. It must have been the young girl's footprint made that morning, for the narrow toe was pointed in the direction she would go. Where she could pass should he shrink from going? Without further hesitation he twined his fingers around the roots above him, and half swung, half pulled himself along until he once more felt the ledge below him. From time to time, as he went on along the difficult track, the narrow little toe print pointed the way to him, like an arrow through the wilds. It was a pleasant thought, and yet a perplexing one. Would he have undertaken this quest just to see her? Would he be content with that if his other motive failed? For as he made his way up to the ridge he was more than once assailed by doubts of the practical success of his enterprise. In the excitement of last night, and even the hopefulness of the early morning, it seemed an easy thing to persuade the vain and eccentric highwayman that their interests might be identical, and to convince him that his, Bryce's, assistance to recover the stolen greenbacks and ensure the punishment of the robber, with the possible addition of a reward from the express company, would be an inducement for them to work together. The risks that he was running seemed to his youthful fancy to atone for any defects in his logic or his plans. Yet as he crossed the ridge, leaving the civilized highway behind him, and descended the narrow trail, which grew wilder at each step, his arguments seemed no longer so convincing. He now hurried forward, however, with a feverish haste to anticipate the worst that might befall him. The trail grew more intricate in the deep ferns, the friendly little footprint had vanished in this primeval wilderness. As he pushed through the gorge, he could hear at last the roar of the North Fork forcing its way through the canyon that crossed the gorge at right angles. At last he reached its current, shut in by two narrow precipitous walls that were spanned 500 feet above by the stage road over a perilous bridge. As he approached the gloomy canyon, he remembered that the river, seen from above, seemed to have no banks, but to have cut its way through the solid rock. He found, however, a faint ledge made by caught driftwood from the current and the debris of the overhanging cliffs. Again the narrow footprint on the ooze was his guide. At last, emerging from the canyon, a strange view burst upon his sight. The river turned abruptly to the right, and, following the mountainside, left a small hollow completely walled in by the surrounding heights. To his left was the ridge he had descended from on the other side, and he now understood the singular detour he had made. He was on the other side of the stage road also, which ran along the mountain shelf 1,000 feet above him. The wall, a sheer cliff, made the hollow inaccessible from that side. Little hills covered with buckeye encompassed it. It looked like a sylvan retreat, and yet was as secure in its isolation and approaches as the outlaw's den that it was. He was gazing at the singular prospect when a shot rang in the air. It seemed to come from a distance, and he interpreted it as a signal. But it was followed presently by another, and putting his hand to his hat to keep it from falling, he found that the upturned brim had been pierced by a bullet. He stopped at this evident hint, and, taking his dispatch bag from his shoulder, placed it significantly upon a boulder, and looked around as if to await the appearance of the unseen marksman. The rifle shot rang out again, the bag quivered, and turned over with a bullet hole through it. He took out his white handkerchief and waved it. Another shot followed, and the handkerchief was snapped from his fingers, torn from corner to corner. A feeling of desperation and fury seized him. He was being played with by a masked and skillful assassin, who only waited until it pleased him to fire the deadly shot. But this time he could see the rifle smoke drifting from under a sycamore not 100 yards away. He set his white lips together, but with a determined face and unfaltering step walked directly towards it. In another moment he believed and almost hoped that all would be over. With such a marksman he would not be maimed, but killed outright. He had not covered half the distance before a man lounged out from behind a tree carelessly shouldering his rifle. He was tall but slightly built, with an amused, critical manner, and nothing about him to suggest the bloodthirsty assassin. He met Bryce halfway, dropping his rifle slantingly across his breast with his hands lightly grasping the lock, and gazed at the young man curiously. "You look as if you'd had a big scare, old man, but you've clear grit for all that," he said, with a critical and reassuring smile. "Now, what are you doing here?" "Stay," he continued, as Bryce's parched lips prevented him from replying immediately. "I ought to know your face. Hello. You're the expressman." His glance suddenly shifted, and swept past Bryce over the ground beyond him to the entrance of the hollow, but his smile returned as he apparently satisfied himself that the young man was alone. "Well, what do you want?"
"I want to see Snapshot Harry," said Bryce, with an effort. His voice came back more slowly than his color, but that was perhaps hurried by a sense of shame at his physical weakness.
"What you want is a drop o' whiskey," said the stranger good-humoredly, taking his arm, "and we'll find it in that shanty just behind the tree." To Bryce's surprise, a few steps in that direction revealed a fair-sized cabin, with a slight pretentiousness about it of neatness, comfort, and picturesque effect, far superior to the tarbox shanty. A few flowers were in boxes on the window signs, as Bryce fancied, of feminine taste. When they reached the threshold, somewhat of this quality was also visible in the interior. When Bryce had partaken of the whiskey, the stranger, who had kept silence, pointed to a chair, and said smilingly, "I am Henry Dimwood, alias Snapshot Harry, and this is my house. I came to speak with you about the robbery of greenbacks from the coach last night," began Bryce hurriedly, with a sudden access of hope at his reception. "I mean, of course," he stopped and hesitated, "the actual robbery before you stopped us."
"What," said Harry, springing to his feet, "do you mean to say you knew it?"
Bryce's heart sank, but he remained steadfast and truthful.
"Yes," he said, "I knew it when I handed down the box. I saw that the lock had been forced, but I snapped it together again. It was my fault. Perhaps I should have warned you, but I am solely to blame."
"Did Yuba Bill know of it?" asked the highwayman, with singular excitement.
"Not at the time, I give you my word," replied Bryce quickly, thinking only of loyalty to his old comrade. "I never told him till we reached the station."
"And he knew it then?" repeated Harry eagerly.
"Yes."
"Did he say anything? Did he do anything? Did he look astonished?"
Bryce remembered Bill's uncontrollable merriment, but replied vaguely and diplomatically, "He was certainly astonished."
A laugh gathered in Snapshot Harry's eyes, which at last overspread his whole face, and finally shook his frame as he sat helplessly down again. Then, wiping his eyes, he said in a shaky voice, "It would have been sure death to have trusted myself near that station, but I think I'd have risked it just to have seen Bill's face when you told him. Just think of it. Bill, who was a match for anybody. Bill, who was never caught napping. Bill, who only wanted supreme control of things to wipe me off the face of the earth. Bill, who knew how everything was done, and could stop it if he chose, and then to have been robbed twice in one evening by my gang.
Yes, sir.
Yuba Bill and his rotten old coach were gone through twice inside half an hour by the gang."
"Then you knew of it too," said Bryce, in uneasy astonishment.
"Afterwards, my young friend, like Yuba Bill afterwards." He stopped, his whole expression changed.
"It was done by two sneaking hounds," he said sharply, "one whom I suspected before, and one, a new hand, a pal of his. They were detached to watch the coach and be satisfied that the greenbacks were aboard, for it isn't my style to hold up except for something special. They were to take seats on the coach as far as Ringwood Station, 3 miles below where we held you up, and to get out there and pass the word to us that it was all right. They didn't, that made us a little extra careful, seeing something was wrong, but never suspecting them. We found out afterwards that they got one of my scouts to cut down that tree, saying it was my orders and a part of our game, calculating in the stoppage and confusion to collar the swag and get off with it. Without knowing it, you played into their hands by going into Tarbox's cabin. But how did you know this? Interrupted Bryce, in wonder. They forgot one thing, continued Snapshot Harry grimly. They forgot that half an hour before and half an hour after a stage is stopped we have that road patrolled, every foot of it. While I was opening the box in the brush, the two fools, sneaking along the road, came slap upon one of my patrols, and then tried to run for it. One was dropped, but before he was plugged full of holes and hung up on a tree, he confessed, and said the other man who escaped had the greenbacks. Bryce's face fell. Then they are lost, he said bitterly. Not unless he eats them as he may want to do before I'm done on him, for he must either starve or come out. That road is still watched by my men from Tarbox's cabin to the bridge. He's there somewhere, and can't get forward or backward. Look, he said, rising and going to the door. That road, he pointed to the stage road, a narrow ledge flanked on one side by a precipitous mountain wall, and on the other by an equally precipitate descent, is his limit and tether, and he can't escape on either side. But the trail? There is but one entrance to it the way you came, and that is guarded too. From the time you entered it until you reached the bottom, you were signaled here from point to point. He would have been dropped. I merely gave you a hint of what might have happened to you, if you were up to any little game. You took it like a white man. Come, now. What is your business? Thus challenged, Bryce plunged with youthful hopefulness into his plan, if, as he voiced it, it seemed to him a little extravagant, he was buoyed up by the frankness of the highwayman, who also had treated the double robbery with a levity that seemed almost as extravagant. He suggested that they should work together to recover the money, that the express company should know that the unprecedented stealthy introduction of robbers in the guise of passengers was not Snapshot Harry's method, and he repudiated it as unmanly and unsportsmanlike, and that, by using his superior skill and knowledge of the locality to recover the money and deliver the culprit into the company's hands, he would not only earn the reward that they should offer, but that he would evoke a sentiment that all Californians would understand and respect. The highwayman listened with a tolerant smile, but, to Bryce's surprise, this appeal to his vanity touched him less than the prospective punishment of the thief. It would serve the DD hound right, he muttered, if, instead of being shot like a man, he was made to do time in prison, like the ordinary sneak thief that he is. When Bryce had concluded, he said briefly, "The only trouble with your plans, my young friend, is that about 25 men have got to consider them, and have their say about it. Every man in my gang is a shareholder in these greenbacks, for I work on the square, and it's for him to say whether he'll give them up for a reward and the good opinion of the express company. Perhaps," he went on, with a peculiar smile, "it's just as well that you tried it on me first. However, I'll sound the boys, and see what comes of it, but not until you're safe off the premises. And you'll let me assist you," said Bryce eagerly. Snapshot Harry smiled again. "Well, if you come across the DD thief, and you recognize him and can get the greenbacks from him, I'll pass over the game to you." He rose and added, apparently by way of farewell, "Perhaps it's just as well that I should give you a guide part of the way to prevent accidents." He went to a door leading to an adjoining room, and called Flo. Bryce's heart leaped. If he had forgotten her in the excitement of his interview, he atoned for it by a vivid blush. Her own color was a little heightened as she slipped into the room, but the two managed to look demurely at each other, without a word of recognition. "This is my niece, Flora," said Snapshot Harry, with a slight wave of the hand that was by no means uncourtly, "and her company will keep you from any impertinent questioning as well as if I were with you. This is Mr. Bryce, Flo, who came to see me on business, and has quite forgotten my practical joking. The girl acknowledged Bryce's bow with a shyness very different from her manner of the evening before. Bryce felt embarrassed and evidently showed it, for his host, with a smile, put an end to the constraint by shaking the young man's hand heartily, bidding him goodbye, and accompanying him to the door. Once on their way, Mr. Bryce's spirits returned. "I told you last night," he said, "that I hope to meet you the next time with a better introduction. You suggested your uncle's. Well, are you satisfied?" "But you didn't come to see me," said the girl mischievously. "How do you know what my intentions were?" returned the young man gaily, gazing at the girl's charming face with a serious doubt as to the singleness of his own intentions. "Oh, because I know," she answered, with a toss of her brown head. "I heard what you said to Uncle Harry." Mr. Bryce's brow contracted. "Perhaps you saw me, too, when I came," he said, with a slight touch of bitterness as he thought of his reception. Miss Flo laughed. Bryce walked on silently. The girl was heartless and worthy of her education. After a pause she said demurely, "I knew he wouldn't hurt you, but you didn't. That's where you showed your grit in walking straight on." "And I suppose you were greatly amused," he replied scornfully. The girl lifted her arms a little wearily, as with a half sigh she readjusted her brown braids under her uncle's gray slouch hat, which she had caught up as she passed out. "There ain't much to laugh at here," she said. "But it was mighty funny when you tried to put your hat straight, and then found Thursday was that bullet hole right through the brim. And the way you stared at it, Lordy." Her musical laugh was infectious, and swept away his outraged dignity. He laughed too. "At last," she said, gazing at his hat, "it won't do for you to go back to your folks wearin' that sort o' thing. Here. Take mine." With a saucy movement she audaciously lifted his hat from his head, and placed her own upon it. "But this is your uncle's hat," he remonstrated. "All the same, he spoiled yours," she laughed, adjusting his hat upon her own head. "But I'll keep yours to remember you by. I'll loop it up by this hole, and it'll look mighty pretty. Just see." She plucked a wild rose from a bush by the wayside, and, passing the stalk through the bullet hole, pinned the brim against the crown by a thorn. "There," she said, putting on the hat again with a little affectation of coquetry, "how's that?" Mr. Bryce thought it very picturesque and becoming to the graceful head and laughing eyes beneath it, and said so. Then, becoming in his turn audacious, he drew nearer to her side. "I suppose you know the forfeit of putting on a gentleman's hat." Apparently she did, for she suddenly made a warning gesture, and said, "Not here. It would be a bigger forfeit than you'd care for." Before he could reply she turned aside as if quite innocently, and passed into the shade of a fringe of buckeyes. He followed quickly. "I didn't mean that," she said, but in the meantime he had kissed the pink tip of her ear under its brown coils. He was, nevertheless, somewhat discomfited by her undisturbed manner and serene face. "Ye don't seem to mind being shot at," she said, with an odd smile, "but it won't do for you to calculate that everybody shoots as carefully as Uncle Harry." "I don't understand," he replied, struck by her manner. "Ye ain't very complimentary, or you'd allow that other folks might be wantin' what you took just now, and might consider you was poachin'," she returned gravely. "My best and strongest hold among those men is that Uncle Harry would kill the first one who tried anything like that on, and they know it. That's how I get all the liberty I want here, and can come and go alone as I like." Bryce's face flushed quickly with genuine shame and remorse. "Do forgive me," he said hurriedly. "I didn't think I'm a brute and a fool. Uncle Harry allowed you was either drunk or a born idiot when you was prominent and into the valley just now," she said, with a smile. "And what did you think?" he asked a little uneasily. "I thought you didn't look like a drinking man," she answered audaciously. Bryce bit his lip and walked on silently, at which she cast a sidelong glance under her widely spaced heavy lashes and said demurely, "I thought last night it was mighty good for you to stand up for your free Nuba Bill, and then, after ye knew who I was, to let the folks see you kinder cottonied to me too. Not in the style o' that land grabber Hex Hill, nor that pert newspaper man, neither. Of course I gave them as good as they sent, she went on, with a little laugh, but Bryce could see that her sensitive lip in profile had the tremulous and resentful curve of one who was accustomed to slight and annoyance. Was it possible that this reckless, self-contained girl felt her position keenly? I am proud to have your good opinion, he said, with a certain respect mingled with his admiring glance, even if I have not your uncle's. Oh, he likes you well enough, or he wouldn't have here ken to you a minute, she said quickly. When you opened out about them greenbacks, I just clutched my cheer so, she illustrated her words with a gesture of her hands, and her face actually seemed to grow pale at the recollection and I nigh started up to stop yeah, but that idea of Yuba Bill Bain robbed twice I think tickled him awful. But it was lucky none o' the gang heard yet or suspected anything. I reckon that's why he sent me with you to keep them from dogging you and asking questions that a straight man like you would be sure to answer. But they daren't come nigh ya as long as I'm with you. She threw back her head and rose-crested hat with a mock air of protection that, however, had a certain real pride in it. I am very glad of that, if it gives me the chance of having your company alone, returned Bryce, smiling, and very grateful to your uncle, whatever were his reasons for making you my guide. But you have already been that to me, and he told her of the footprints. But for you, he added, with gentle significance, I should not have been here. She was silent for a moment, and he could only see the back of her head and its heavy brown coils. After a pause she asked abruptly, where's your handkerchief? He took it from his pocket, her ingenious uncle's bullet had torn rather than pierced the cambric. I thought so, she said, gravely examining it, but I can mend it as good as new. I reckon you allow I can't so, she continued, but I do heaps of mendin', as the digger squaw and chin a men we have here do only the coarser work. I'll send it back to you, and meanwhiles you keep mine. She drew a handkerchief from her pocket and handed it to him. To his great surprise it was a delicate one, beautifully embroidered, and utterly incongruous to her station. The idea that flashed upon him, it is to be feared, showed itself momentarily in his hesitation and embarrassment. She gave a quick laugh. Don't be frightened. It's bought and paid for. Uncle Harry don't touch passengers' fixins, that ain't his style. You oughter know that. Yet in spite of her laugh, he could see the sensitive pout of her lower lip. I was only thinking, he said hurriedly and sympathetically, that it was too fine for me. But I will be proud to keep it as a souvenir of you. It's not too pretty for that. Uncle gets me these things. He don't care what they cost, she went on, ignoring the compliment. Why, I've got awfully fine gowns up there that I only wear when I go to Marysville once it in a while. Does he take you there? Asked Bryce. No, she answered quietly. Not a little defiantly that he's afeard, for they can't prove anything against him, no man can swear to him, and there ain't an officer that cares to go for him. But he's that shy for me he don't care to have me mixed with him. But nobody recognizes you. Sometimes but I don't care for that. She cocked her hat a little audaciously, but Bryce noticed that her arms afterwards dropped at her side with the same weary gesture he had observed before. Whenever I go into shops it's always yes, miss, and no, miss, and certainly, Miss Dimwood. Oh, they're mighty respectful. I reckon they allow that Snapshot Harry's rifle carries far. Presently she faced him again, for their conversation had been carried on in profile. There was a critical, searching look in her brown eyes. Here I'm talking to you as if you were one. Mr. Bryce was positive she was going to say one of the gang, but she hesitated and concluded, one of my relations like Cousin Hiram. I wish you would think of me as being as true a friend, said the young man earnestly. She did not reply immediately, but seemed to be examining the distance. They were not far from the canyon now, and the river bank. A fringe of buckeyes hid the base of the mountain, which had begun to tower up above them to the invisible stage road overhead. I am going to be a real guide to you now, she said suddenly. When we reach that buckeye corner and are out of sight, we will turn into it instead of going through the canyon. You shall go up the mountain to the stage road, from this side. But it is impossible, he exclaimed, in astonishment. Your uncle said so. Coming down, but not going up, she returned, with a laugh. I found it, and no one knows it but myself. He glanced up at the towering cliff, its nearly perpendicular flanks were seamed with fissures, some clefts deeply set with stunted growths of thorn and scrub, but still sheer and forbidding, and then glanced back at her incredulously. I will show you, she said, answering his look with a smile of triumph. I haven't tramped over this whole valley for nothing. But wait until we reach the river bank. They must think that we've gone through the canyon. They? Yes, anyone who is watching us, said the girl dryly. A few steps further on brought them to the buckeye thicket, which extended to the river bank and mouth of the canyon. The girl lingered for a moment ostentatiously before it, and then, saying come, suddenly turned at right angles into the thicket. Bryce followed, and the next moment they were hidden by its friendly screen from the valley. On the other side rose the mountain wall, leaving a narrow trail before them. It was composed of the rocky debris and fallen trees of the cliff, from which buckeyes and larches were now springing. It was uneven, irregular, and slowly ascending, but the young girl led the way with the free footstep of a mountaineer, and yet a grace that was akin to delicacy. Nor could he fail to notice that, after the Western girl's fashion, she was shod more elegantly and lightly than was consistent with the rude and rustic surroundings. It was the same slim shoe print which had guided him that morning. Presently she stopped, and seemed to be gazing curiously at the cliffside. Bryce followed the direction of her eyes. On a protruding bush at the edge of one of the wooded clefts of the mountain flank something was hanging, and in the freshening southerly wind was flapping heavily, like a raven's wing, or as if still saturated with the last night's rain. That's mighty queer, said Flo, gazing intently at the unsightly and incongruous attachment to the shrub, which had a vague, weird suggestion. It wasn't there yesterday. It looks like a man's coat, remarked Bryce uneasily. Whew, said the girl. Then somebody has come down who won't go up again. There's a lot of fresh rocks and brush here, too. What's that? She was pointing to a spot some yards before them where there had been a recent precipitation of debris and uprooted shrubs. But mingled with it lay a mass of rags strangely akin to the tattered remnant that flagged from the bush 100 feet above them. The girl suddenly uttered a sharp feminine cry of mingled horror and disgust, the first weakness of sex she had shown, and, recoiling, grasped Bryce's arm. Don't go there. Come away. But Bryce had already seen that which, while it shocked him, was urging him forward with an invincible fascination. Gently releasing himself, and bidding the girl stand back, he moved toward the unsightly heap. Gradually it disclosed a grotesque caricature of a human figure, but so maimed and doubled up that it seemed a stuffed and fallen scarecrow. As is common in men stricken suddenly down by accident in the fullness of life, the clothes asserted themselves before all else with a hideous ludicrousness, obliterating even the majesty of death in their helpless yet iron-ical incongruity. The garments seemed to have never fitted the wearer, but to have been assumed in ghastly jocularity, a boot half off the swollen foot, a ripped waistcoat thrown over the shoulder, were like the properties of some low comedian. At first the body appeared to be headless, but as Bryce cleared away the debris and lifted it, he saw with horror that the head was twisted under the shoulder, and swung helplessly from the dislocated neck. But that horror gave way to a more intense and thrilling emotion as he saw the face, although strangely free from laceration or disfigurement, and empurpled and distended into the simulation of a self-complacent smile, was a face he recognized. It was the face of the cynical traveler in the coach, the man who he was now satisfied had robbed it. A strange and selfish resentment took possession of him. Here was the man through whom he had suffered shame and peril, and who even now seemed complacently victorious in death. He examined him closely. His coat and waistcoat had been partly torn away in his fall, His shirt still clung to him, but through its torn front could be seen a heavy treasure belt encircling his waist. Forgetting his disgust, Bryce tore away the shirt and unloosed the belt. It was saturated with water like the rest of the clothing, but its pocket seemed heavy and distended. In another instant he had opened it, and discovered the envelope containing the packet of greenbacks, its seal still inviolate and unbroken. It was the stolen treasure. A faint sigh recalled him to himself. The girl was standing a few feet from him, regarding him curiously. "It's the thief himself," he said, in a breathless explanation. "In trying to escape he must have fallen from the road above. But here are the greenbacks safe. We must go back to your uncle at once," he said excitedly. "Come. Are you mad?" she cried, in astonishment. "No," returned Bryce, in equal astonishment, "but you know I agreed with him that we should work together to recover the money, and I must show him our good luck. He told you that if you met the thief and could get the money from him, you were welcome to it," said the girl gravely, "and you have got it." "But not in the way he meant," returned Bryce hurriedly. "This man's death is the result of his attempting to escape from your uncle's guards along the road. The merit of it belongs to them and your uncle. It would be cowardly and mean of me to take advantage of it." The girl looked at him with an expression of mingled admiration and pity. "But the guards were placed there before he ever saw you," said she impatiently. "And whatever Uncle Harry may want to do, he must do what the gang says. And with the money once in their possession, or even in yours, if they knew it, I wouldn't give much for its chances or yours either for getting out o' this hollow again. But if they are treacherous, that is no reason why I should be so," protested Bryce stoutly. "You've no right to say they were treacherous when they knew nothing of your plans," said the girl sharply. "Your company would have more call to say you were treacherous to it for making a plan without consulting them." Bryce winced, for he had never thought of that before. "You can offer that reward after you get away from here with the greenbacks. But," she added proudly, with a toss of her head, "go back if you want to. Tell him all. Tell him where you found it. Tell him I did not take you through the canyon, but was showing you a new trail I had never shown to them. Tell him that I am a traitor, for I have given them and him away to you, a stranger, and that you consider yourself the only straight and honest one about here." Bryce flushed with shame. "Forgive me," he said hurriedly, "you are right and I am wrong again. I will do just what you say. I will first place these greenbacks in a secure place and then—" "Get away first, that's your only hold," she interrupted him quickly, her eyes still flashing through indignant tears. "Come quick, for I must put you on the trail before they miss me." She darted forward, he followed, but she kept the lead, as much, he fancied, to evade his observation as to expedite his going. Presently they stopped before the sloping trunk of a huge pine that had long since fallen from the height above, but, although splintered where it had broken ground, had preserved some 50 feet of its straight trunk erect and leaning like a ladder against the mountain wall. "There," she said, hurriedly pointing to its decaying but still projecting lateral branches, "you climb it. I have. At the top you'll find it stuck in a cleft among the brush. There's a little hollow and an old waterway from a spring above which makes a trail through the brush. It's as good as the trail you took from the stage road this morning, but it's not as safe coming down. Keep along it to the spring, and it will land ye just the other side of Uncle Hiram's cabin. Go quick. I'll wait here until ye've reached the cleft. But you," he said, turning toward her, "how can I ever thank you?" As if anticipating a leave-taking, the girl had already withdrawn herself a few yards away, and simply made an upward gesture with her hand. "Quick. Up with you. Every minute now is a risk to me." Thus appealed to, Bryce could only comply. Perhaps he was a little hurt at the girl's evident desire to avoid a gentler parting. Securing his prized envelope within his breast, he began to ascend the tree. Its inclination, and the aid offered by the broken stumps of branches, made this comparatively easy, and in a few moments he reached its top, and stood upon a little ledge in the wall. A swift glance around him revealed the whole waterway or fissure slanting upward along the mountain face. Then he turned quickly to look down the dizzy height. At first he could distinguish nothing but the top of the buckeyes and their white clustering blossoms. Then something fluttered the torn white handkerchief of his that she had kept. And then he caught a single glimpse of the flower-plumed hat receding rapidly among the trees, and Flora Dimwood was gone. 3. In 24 hours Edward Bryce was in San Francisco. But although successful and the bearer of the treasure, it is doubtful if he approached this end of his journey with the temerity he had shown on entering the Robbers' Valley. A consciousness that the methods he had employed might excite the ridicule, if not the censure, of his principals, or that he might have compromised them in his meeting with Snapshot Harry, considerably modified his youthful exultation. It is possible that Flora's reproach, which still rankled in his mind, may have quickened his sensitiveness on that point. However, he had resolved to tell the whole truth, except his episode with Flora, and to place the conduct of Snapshot Harry and the Tarboxes in as favorable a light as possible. But first he had recourse to the manager, a man of shrewd worldly experience, who had recommended him to his place. When he had finished and handed him the treasured envelope, the man looked at him with a critical and yet not unkindly expression. "Perhaps it's just as well, Bryce, that you did come to me at first, and did not make your report to the president and directors. I suppose," said Bryce diffidently, "that they wouldn't have liked my communicating with the highwayman without their knowledge. More than that, they wouldn't have believed your story." "Not believe it," cried Bryce, flushing quickly. "Do you think?" The manager checked him with a laugh. "Hold on. I believe every word of it, and why? Because you've added nothing to it to make yourself the regular hero. Why, with your opportunity, and no one able to contradict you, you might have told me you had a hand-to-hand fight with the thief, and had to kill him to recover the money, and even brought your handkerchief and hat back with the bullet holes to prove it." Bryce winked as he thought of the fair possessor of those articles. "But as a story for general circulation, it won't do. Have you told it to anyone else? Does anyone know what happened but yourself?" Bryce thought of Flora, but he had resolved not to compromise her, and he had a consciousness that she would be equally loyal to him. "No one," he answered boldly. "Very good. And I suppose you wouldn't mind if it were kept out of the newspapers? You're not hankering after a reputation as a hero." "Certainly not," said Bryce indignantly. "Well, then, we'll keep it where it is. You will say nothing. I will hand over the greenbacks to the company, but only as much of your story as I think they'll stand. You're all right as it is. Yuba Bill has already set you up in his report to the company, and the recovery of this money will put you higher. Only, the public need know nothing about it." "But," asked Bryce amazedly, "how can it be prevented? The shippers who lost the money will have to know that it has been recovered. Why should they? The company will assume the risk, and repay them just the same. It's a great deal better to have the reputation for accepting the responsibility than for the shippers to think that they only get their money through the accident of its recovery." Bryce gasped at this large business truth. Besides, it occurred to him that it kept the secret, and Flora's participation in it, from Snapshot Harry and the gang. He had not thought of that before. "Come," continued the manager, with official curtness. "What do you say? Are you willing to leave it to me?" Bryce hesitated a moment. It was not what his impulsive, truthful nature had suggested. It was not what his youthful fancy had imagined. He had not worked upon the sympathies of the company on behalf of Snapshot Harry as he believed he would do. He had not even impressed the manager. His story, far from exciting a chivalrous sentiment, had been pronounced improbable. Yet he reflected he had so far protected her, and he consented with a sigh. Nevertheless, the result ought to have satisfied him. A dazzling check, enclosed in a letter of thanks from the company the next day, and his promotion from the road to the San Francisco office, would have been quite enough for anyone but Edward Bryce. Yet he was grateful, albeit a little frightened and remorseful over his luck. He could not help thinking of the kindly tolerance of the highwayman, the miserable death of the actual thief, which had proved his own salvation, and above all the generous, high-spirited girl who had aided his escape. While on his way to San Francisco, and yet in the first glow of his success, he had written her a few lines from Marysville, enclosed in a letter to Mr. Tarbox. He had received no reply. Then a week passed. He wrote again, and still no reply. Then a vague feeling of jealousy took possession of him as he remembered her warning hint of the attentions to which she was subjected, and he became singularly appreciative of Snapshot Harry's proficiency as a marksman. Then, cruelest of all, for your impassioned lover is no lover at all if not cruel in his imaginings, he remembered how she had evaded her uncle's espionage with him, could she not equally with another? Perhaps that was why she had hurried him away, why she had prevented his returning to her uncle. Following this came another week of disappointment and equally miserable cynical philosophy, in which he persuaded himself he was perfectly satisfied with his material advancement, that it was the only outcome of his adventure to be recognized, and he was more miserable than ever. A month had passed, when one morning he received a small package by post. The address was in a handwriting unknown to him, but opening the parcel he was surprised to find only a handkerchief neatly folded. Examining it closely, he found it was his own, the one he had given her, the rent made by her uncle's bullet so ingeniously and delicately mended as to almost simulate embroidery. The joy that suddenly filled him at this proof of her remembrance showed him too plainly how hollow had been his cynicism and how lasting his hope. Turning over the wrapper eagerly, he discovered what he had at first thought was some business card. It was, indeed, printed and not engraved, in some common newspaper type, and bore the address, Hiram Tarbox, Land and Timber Agent, 1101 California Street. He again examined the parcel, there was nothing else, not a line from her. But it was a clue at last, and she had not forgotten him. He seized his hat, and 10 minutes later was breasting the steep sand hill into which California Street in those days plunged, and again emerged at its crest, with a few struggling houses. But when he reached the summit he could see that the outline of the street was still plainly marked along the distance by cottages and new suburban villa-like blocks of houses. Number 1101 was in one of these blocks, a small tenement enough, but a palace compared to Mr. Tarbox's Sierran cabin. He impetuously rang the bell, and without waiting to be announced dashed into the little drawing room and Mr. Tarbox's presence. That had changed too. Mr. Tarbox was arrayed in a suit of clothes as new, as cheaply decorative, as fresh and, apparently, as damp as his own drawing room. Did you get my letter? Did you give her the one I enclosed? Why didn't you answer? Burst out Bryce, after his first breathless greeting. Mr. Tarbox's face here changed so suddenly into his old dejected doggedness that Bryce could have imagined himself back in the Sierran cabin. The man straightened and bowed himself at Bryce's questions, and then replied with bold, deliberate emphasis. Yes, I did get your letter. I didn't give no letter o' yours to her. And I didn't answer your letter before, for I didn't propose to answer it at all. Why? Demanded Bryce indignantly. I didn't give her your letter because I didn't calculate to be any go-between twixt you and Snapshot Harry's niece. Look yar, Mr. Bryce. Since I read that AR paragraph in that paper you gave me, I allowed to myself that it wasn't the square thing for me to have any more doin's with him, and I quit it. I just chucked your letter in the fire. I didn't answer you because I reckoned I'd no call to correspond with ye, and when I showed ye that trail over to Harry's camp, it was ended. I've got a house and business to look arter, and it don't jibe with keepin' company with road agents. That's what I got outer that paper you gave me, Mr. Bryce. Rage and disgust filled Bryce at the man's utter selfishness and shameless desertion of his kindred, none the less powerfully that he remembered the part he himself had played in concocting the paragraph. Do you mean to say, he demanded passionately, that for the sake of that foolish paragraph you gave up your own kindred? That you truckled to the mean prejudices of your neighbors and kept that poor, defenseless girl from the only honest roof she could find refuge under? That you dared to destroy my letter to her, and made her believe I was as selfish and ungrateful as yourself? Young feller, said Mr. Tarbox still more deliberately, yet with a certain dignity that Bryce had never noticed before, what's between you and Flo, and what rights she has for thinking ye easy selfish and easy ungrateful easy me if she does, I dunno, but when ye talk o' me giving up my kindred, and sling such hogwash easy ungrateful and selfish round this here sitting room, mebbe it mout occur to ye that Harry Dimwood might heve his opinion o' what was ungrateful and selfish if I'd played in between his niece and a young man o' the express company, his natural enemy. It's one thing to heve helped ye to see her in her uncle's own camp, but another to help ye by making a clandestine post office o' my cabin. F, instead o' writing, you'd heve posted yourself by coming to me, you mout heve found out that when I broke with Harry I offered to take Flo with me for good and all if he'd keep away from us. And that's the kind o' honest roof that thar poor defenseless girl got under when her crippled mother died 3 weeks ago, and left Harry free. It was by truckling to them mean prejudices, and reading that thar foolish paragraph, that I settled this thing then and thar. Bryce's revulsion of sentiment was so complete, and the gratitude that beamed in his eyes was so sincere, that Mr. Tarbox hardly needed the profuse apologies which broke from him. Forgive me, he continued to stammer, I have wronged you, wronged her everybody. But as you know, Mr. Tarbox, how I have felt over this, how deeply, how passionately. It does make a man loony sometimes, said Mr. Tarbox, relaxing into demure dryness again, so I reckon you did. Mebbe she reckons so, too, for she asked me to give you the handkercher I sent yet. It looked as if she'd been doing some fancy work on it. Bryce glanced quickly at Mr. Tarbox's face. It was stolid and imperturbable. She had evidently kept the secret of what passed in the hollow to herself. For the first time he looked around the room curiously. I didn't know you were a land agent before, he said. No more I was. All that came out o' that paragraph, Mr. Bryce. That man Hex Hill, who was so mighty perlite that night, wrote to me afterwards that he didn't know my name till he'd seed that paragraph, and he wanted to know if, easy a well-known citizen, I could recommend him some timber lands. I recommended him half o' my own quarter section, and he took it. He's puttin' up a mill thar, and that's another reason why we want peace and quietness up thar. I'm tryin', betwixt and between us, Mr. Bryce, to get Harry to CLAR out and sell his rights in the valley and the water power on the fork to Hex Hill and me. I'm opening a business here. Then you've left Mrs. Tarbox with Miss Flora in your cabin while you attend to business here, said Bryce tentatively. Not exactly, Mr. Bryce. The old woman thought it a good chance to come to Frisco and put Flo in one o' them Catholic convent schools that asks no questions where the raw logs come from, and turns em out first-class plank all round. You foller me, Mr. Bryce? But Mrs. Tarbox is just in the next room, and would admire to tell ye all this and I'll go in and send her to you. And with a patronizing wave of the hand, Mr. Tarbox complacently disappeared in the hall. Mr. Bryce was not sorry to be left to himself in his utter bewilderment. Flo, separated from her detrimental uncle, and placed in a convent school. Tarbox, the obscure pioneer, a shrewd speculator emerging into success, and taking the uncle's place. And all this within that month which he had wasted with absurd repinings. How feeble seemed his own adventure and advancement, how even ludicrous his pretensions to any patronage and superiority. How this common backwoodsman had set him in his place as easily as she had evaded the advances of the journalist and Hex Hill. They had taught him a lesson, perhaps even the sending back of his handkerchief was part of it. His heart grew heavy, he walked to the window and gazed out with a long sigh. A light laugh, that might have been an echo of the one which had attracted him that night in Tarbox's cabin, fell upon his ear. He turned quickly to meet Flora Dimwood's laughing eyes shining upon him as she stood in the doorway. Many a time during that month he had thought of this meeting, had imagined what it would be like, what would be his manner towards her, what would be her greeting, and what they would say. He would be cold, gentle, formal, gallant, gay, sad, trustful, reproachful, even as the moods in which he thought of her came to his foolish brain. He would always begin with respectful seriousness, or a frankness equal to her own, but never, never again would he offend as he had offended under the Buckeyes. And now, with her pretty face shining upon him, all his plans, his speeches, his preparations vanished, and left him dumb. Yet he moved towards her with a brief articulate something on his lips, something between a laugh and a sigh, but that really was a kiss, and in point of fact promptly folded her in his arms. Yet it was certainly direct, and perhaps the best that could be done, for the young lady did not emerge from it as coolly, as unemotionally, nor possibly as quickly as she had under the shade of the Buckeyes. But she persuaded him by still holding his hand to sit beside her on the chilly, highly varnished green rep sofa, albeit to him it was a bank in a bower of enchantment. Then she said, with adorable reproachfulness, "You don't ask what I did with the body." Mr. Edward Bryce started. He was young, and unfamiliar with the evasive expansiveness of the female mind at such supreme moments. "The body, oh, yes, certainly. I buried it myself, it was something too awful, and the gang would have been sure to have found it, and the empty belt. I burned that. So that nobody knows nothing." It was not a time for strictly grammatical negatives, and I am afraid that the girl's characteristically familiar speech, even when pathetically corrected here and there by the influence of the convent, endeared her the more to him. And when she said, "And now, Mr. Edward Bryce, sit over at that end of the sofa and let's talk," they talked. They talked for an hour, more or less continuously, until they were surprised by a discreet cough and the entrance of Mrs. Tarbox. Then there was more talk, and the discovery that Mr. Bryce was long due at the office. "Ye might drop in, now and then, whenever ye feel like it, and Flo is at home," suggested Mrs. Tarbox at parting. Mr. Bryce did drop in frequently during the next month. On one of these occasions Mr. Tarbox accompanied him to the door. "And now easy, everything is settled and in order, Mr. Bryce, and if you should be wantin' to say anything about it to your bosses at the office, ye may mention my name, easy, Flo Dimwood's second cousin, and say I'm a depositor in their bank. And, with greater deliberation, if anything at any time should be thrown up at ye for marrying a niece o' Snapshot Harry's, ye might mention, careless like, that Snapshot Harry, under the name o' Henry J. Dimwood, has held shares in their old bank for years.